The sunrise, the symbol of a new beginning. Years ago, young Jeffrey wouldn't have been able to even glance at its brilliance, but now he gets up every morning to see it. What follows is a story about overcoming fear. The fear of the color orange. This is Jeffrey Amber, a 20-year-old student pursuing his English degree at Oakton University. By all accounts, he's your average college student, but throughout his childhood, he struggled with a crippling phobia.
He was incredibly, incredibly distraught when he first walked into my office. And his mother told me that he was shut up in his room, you know, he was crying all hours of the night. It was terrible to watch, actually. He had goggles on. You know, all sides blocked off. He came in, he started shouting randomly. Words that, you know, incongruent words, not making any sense. So I told him, you know, I'm your friend. I'm here to understand you.
There was an incident, PE. A child brought his own ball to dodgeball. I'm not quite sure why, because it seems a pretty weird thing for a child to do, but he did. And Jeffrey, well, of course, you know, it was orange. And Jeffrey got hit in the face with it. I've never seen anyone go down that hard. I came up to him, and I said, you know, what's wrong? I said, get up, boy. Get up. And he said, no. I said, why? What's your problem, kid? And he just shed a single tear.
I first met Jeffrey when I was in third grade. And I don't know why, I just really wanted to be his friend. But the first time I came up to him, he wet himself and ran away. And I didn't really know what to think of that, so I came up to him later, and this time he smacked me and ran away. And, you know, that was a stronger message, I guess.
Jeffrey's troubles and fear of orange quickly spread to all aspects of his social life. Even in school, he couldn't escape his phobia.
One of the best aspects of our school is we feature snack time after gym. This was probably the worst feature of our school for Jeffrey, hands down, because a very popular snack with a lot of kids are carrots, orange gushers, oranges, other orange snack foods. So Jeffrey would go out there and oftentimes he'd get very upset. He would wet himself. One time he ripped out a chunk of a young girl's hair. She was just eating fruit snacks.
Oh, my little Jeffrey, my sweet little Jeffrey. Oh, he used to play checkers with Mom, and we used to have picnics and go to the park. Every Sunday we would go to the park, and we would have picnics. But, you know, he was such a sweet boy, but he had an incident.
When Jeffrey first told me about the orange incident, it was 7 months into our treatment. Quite difficult, actually, to get it out of him. But in the end, my methods, as they usually do, came to fruition. And he told me that he was walking by the orchard.
And I saw some of the big kids, you know, like fifth, sixth graders, you know, those types of kids.
Stealing oranges from the orchard. He just couldn't walk by, you know, as a brave, brave boy he is. He told them, shan't be doing that now. Stop it. And they didn't take too kindly.
Well, there was this big guy. His name was Tony. He just looked at me. He had yellow teeth, and he held an orange in his hand. He tossed it up in the air lightly, back and forth. I could still hear the sound of the orange skin hitting the palm of his hand.
The mayhem began suddenly. The middle schoolers, relentless in their torment, flung oranges to the left and to the right. When it was finally all over, only carnage remained. Jeffrey had been pelted unconscious. He lay on the sidewalk, pulpy and broken, much as the oranges that surrounded him.
Well, after the incident, I started to notice that Jeffrey wasn't responding to certain things the way that he used to. I couldn't cut up carrot sticks for him, and I couldn't take him to see the sunset anymore. He was still Mommy's little boy, but he wasn't the same little boy. And all the love in the world that I could give him, it just wasn't enough. And Mommy tried to make it all better. Mommy tried to give him his orange juice and his fruity pebbles, but he just wouldn't eat them. So that's when I started looking for doctors, and we found Dr. Winkleman.
I am a specialist in the field of chromophobia, with a certain emphasis on chrysophobia, which is actually the fear of orange, and the recovery process that comes with it. Jeffrey is a phenomenal student. He's my most successful patient so far. He's an inspiration to us all, in my field especially. I've written a few books, and they look into the subject more thoroughly, if you want to give them a look. I studied in the field for over 10 years, and what I've learned is that this is an epidemic that can hit anyone, and we have to be prepared for it.
It was hard for a very long time, but he started going to sessions, and he started getting better, and working with the psychologist. Now we're really good friends. We hang out every weekend, and it's really great, and he never pees his pants anymore.
I took some bananas and some oranges and took him into the fields of Florida. It cost me a lot of money, but it was worth it in the end. We took him to Florida, took him to an orchard, and made him pick oranges from the trees. He was terrified. It took him 2 hours just to muster the courage to get out of the car, you know. He had his goggles on. No, he wouldn't take them off. It was an event. But we got through it. We got him to touch the oranges.
He started eating an orange right in front of me.
Some people might not agree with my methods.
I pissed my pants and I punched him in the face.
I wanted to gauge his reaction. His mother told me that he hadn't touched Sunny D in years, and that used to be his favorite. Again, I wanted to get to the bottom of that. It was kind of an odd statement. I didn't really talk much. He just told me about this Sunny D. So I bought him some Sunny D. Again, he was screaming, top of his lungs. But as the funnel I put into his face, it was kind of, you know, intense, but as the funnel began to take shape, he accepted it into his mouth. Sunny D came back into his life full fold. Can't stop drinking it, you know, to this day. It's one of our little jokes, you know. Still drinking that Sunny D, eh? Yeah, he is.
Well, you know, it's still hard sometimes. Like, when I go to the grocery store and I'm in the produce section, I always find myself staring at the oranges, and, you know, little kids, they look at me and they ask their mothers, what's wrong with that man? And it's hard not to, you know, break down right there, because I've come so far, but it's still a challenge.
Jeffrey Amber teaches us an important lesson. When life gives you oranges, make Sunny D.